Good morning.
Good morning.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We gather this morning to hear the word of our Lord, to receive his Holy Supper, and to celebrate his gifts. We'll be dedicating our new eternal light during the service. Also, welcoming warmly some new members joining our congregation. As we begin this time of worship, we invite you to greet those around you with the peace of the Lord. Morning, Jesus speaks to the woman at the well of living water. That's our sermon text. It's also a theme of our opening hymn 435. Dedication of our eternal light. It is a light which burns continually, reminding us of God's presence here in this place of worship, also God's presence that goes with us throughout the week. We're thankful for a new eternal light that doesn't have a broken chain and that is nice and shiny and shows forth the light of Christ. Please rise. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Beloved in the Lord, Moses was commanded by the Lord to receive gifts from the people for the beautification of the sanctuary. Everyone whose heart stirred and whose spirit was moved brought a contribution to the Lord to be used in the Lord's house in all its services. Since the Lord has taught us in his holy word that everything is sanctified by the word of God and prayer, it is fitting that we bless and sanctify this eternal light for use here in God's holy house. Our help is in the name of the Lord,
who made heaven and earth.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, you have directed us to bring offerings for your glory. We implore you to bless this eternal light. Grant that it may reflect our love for you, benefit your church, and bring joy to those who worship here. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit bless this eternal light and those who worship here. Amen. Our service continues, page 203. Our help is in the name of the Lord. If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand?
But in you there is forgiveness, therefore you are here.
Since we are gathered to hear God's word, call upon him in prayer and praise, and receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ in the fellowship of this altar. Let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ, and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Almighty God,
have mercy upon us, forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life.
Almighty God, merciful Father, in holy baptism, you declared us to be your children and gathered us into your one holy church, in which you daily and richly forgive us our sins and grant us new life through your Spirit. Be in our midst, enliven our faith, and graciously receive our prayer and praise through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. I invite you to join in the reading of the intro. It's found on an insert in your bulletin for this third Sunday in Lent. Blessed are those whose strength is in you, in whose heart are the highways to Zion. How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts. My soul longs, yes, faints for the courts of the Lord. My heart and flesh sing for joy to the living God. Even the sparrow finds a home, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may lay her young. At your altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God, blessed are those who dwell in your house, ever singing your praise. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
Truth of your word.
Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Old Testament reading for the third Sunday in Lent is from Exodus chapter 17. These words connect with our gospel reading as they also speak of water. All the congregation of the people of Israel moved on from the wilderness of Sin by stages according to the commandment of the Lord and camped at Rephidim. But there was no water for the people to drink. Therefore the people quarreled with Moses and said, "Give us water to drink." And Moses said to them, "Why do you quarrel with me? Why do you test the Lord?" But the people thirsted there for water, and the people grumbled against Moses and said, "Why did you bring us up out of Egypt to kill us and our children and our livestock with thirst?" So Moses cried to the Lord, "What shall I do with this people? They are almost ready to stone me." And the Lord said to Moses, "Pass on before the people, taking with you some of the elders of Israel, and take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile, and go. Behold, I will stand before you there on the rock at Horeb, and you shall strike the rock, and water shall come out of it, and the people will drink." And Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. And he called the name of the place Massa at Meribah, because of the quarreling of the people of Israel, and because they tested the Lord by saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?" This is the word of the Lord. The epistle from Romans chapter 5. Paul speaks of all that we have because we have the gift of faith. Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him, we have also obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand, and we rejoice in hope of the glory of God. More than that, we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, who has been given to us. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise for the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 4th chapter. Glory to you, Lord. These words serve as our sermon text. Jesus came to a town of Samaria called Sychar, near the field that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, so Jesus, weary as he was from his journey, was sitting beside the well. It was about the 6th hour. There came a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." For his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a woman of Samaria, for Jews have no dealings with Samaritans. Jesus answered her, if you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, give me a drink, you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water. The woman said to him, sir, you have nothing to draw water with, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob? He gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did his sons and his livestock. Jesus said to her, everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty forever. The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life. The woman said to him, sir, give me this water so that I will not be thirsty or have to come here to draw water. Jesus said to her, go, call your husband and come here. The woman answered, I have no husband. Jesus said to her, you are right in saying, I have no husband. For you have had five husbands, and the one you now have is not your husband. What you have said is true. The woman said to him, sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. Our fathers worshiped on this mountain, but you say that in Jerusalem is the place where people ought to worship. Jesus said to her, woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming and is now here when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for the Father is seeking such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth. The woman said to him, I know that Messiah is coming, he who is called Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things. Jesus said to her, I who speak to you am he. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
In response, we confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed, page 206. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the Grace, mercy, and peace to each of you from God our Father, from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Water. It's absolutely essential. Essential for us every day. Essential for life. Most of us have seen pictures recently, I think, of the drought that is going on in parts of Africa. A couple of years with almost no rain. Everything drying up. Crops and food. And water. Pools and wells going dry. Farmers that are losing almost all their livestock. Even people, young and old, dying. All because of a lack of water. It is essential to life. It's the theme of our text today. We look at our text in three parts. First of all, we see a thirsty woman. This woman comes to the well. But our text says it's the sixth hour. It's the hot time of the day. Not the time you normally came to the well. But maybe there's a reason for that. Maybe she wants to avoid the other women coming to the well. Wants to avoid the whispers and the gossip. After all, she's been married 5 times. Now she's living with someone else. She comes to the well because she's thirsty. But Jesus comes there because he knows that she is spiritually thirsty, morally thirsty, morally a mess. Jesus begins the conversation, asks her for some water. She's surprised. He's violating all kinds of norms by asking. He's a man. She's a woman. He's a Jew. She is a Samaritan. She questions this. Jesus points her to why he's really striking up this conversation, that he has something that she needs, living water. The woman is surprised. She says, "How? How can you get any water? You can't even get physical water for yourself. Where would you go? How would you draw such water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who dug this well for us, drank from it, gave it to us, put it in this place?" Of course, the answer is yes. She's in the presence of one far greater than Jacob. Eventually, she comes around. She says, "Yes, give me some of this water. It sounds good." Now that she's open, Jesus leads her a bit farther. He says, "Call your husband." Knowing, of course, she has no husband. And she responds, "I have none." And Jesus says, "Yes, that's true, but you've had 5 and you're with someone else now." The woman is surprised that this stranger would know all these details about her. She perceives Jesus, he's a prophet. He has this knowledge in a special way. It's knowledge of God. And because the conversation is going in perhaps an uncomfortable direction, she quickly changes the topic. "Well, if you're a prophet, sir, settle this debate, this dispute. Do we Samaritans, do we have to go to Jerusalem to worship? Isn't this mountain good? After all, Jacob's well is here. Why can't we worship here? Jesus responds about what true worship is. It's not about place, but it's about what is in our heart, and it's about the Holy Spirit. It's about worshiping in truth. Jesus comes to this thirsty woman to give her not physical water, but that which she needs even more, that which she is dying without, the gift of spiritual water. We, my friends, are also thirsty. We are thirsty people. Even if we had plenty of coffee or juice or milk or water to drink this morning, we are still thirsty people. You see, this text is not just about a thirsty woman, about a Samaritan woman. It's about us. We, in fact, can see ourselves in her. We find ourselves as outsiders, as Samaritans, as ones who don't fit in. We don't fit in with the rest of society. And we look at ourselves and we know our own sins. We know our five sins, or our 500 sins, or actually a whole lot more than that. And so we recognize that we are thirsty, that spiritually we are in the midst of a drought. Sometimes we find ourselves looking for spiritual shortcuts. Give me some of this water so I don't have to come back. Let me be baptized and that'll take care of me for the rest of my life. I'll be set. Let me be confirmed and I won't need to bother to come to church anymore. We look for spiritual shortcuts in our lives. Do I really need to take time for devotions? Do I need to pray today? I have so much else to do. And we, like the woman, we change the topic when it gets uncomfortable. We focus on something else rather than what is the true need, the true issue. And most of all, like this woman at the well, we need the Messiah. We need the Christ, the one who comes to make all things right. We are spiritually thirsty. Without Christ, our souls are parched in a drought. You see, sin is not just a couple of actions that we need a shot of water here and there, but sin is a condition. It impacts all of us. Not just a dry spot here and there, but major drought. It's what sin does to us, to our hearts, to our lives. There's a thirsty woman, but there's a whole church full here. We are all thirsty people, spiritually thirsty. And that brings us to the real point of our text. And that is living water, the living water of Jesus. Jesus came to that woman. It was intentional. She came at an odd time of the day, but he was there, knowing she would come. The disciples were gone so that he could have time just with her, that he might offer her exactly what she needs, that he might fill her with living water. And my friends, Jesus comes to us. He seeks us out in our thirst, in our drought. He comes with living water to quench our sin-parched souls. Jesus comes as the prophet the one who knows all about us, who knows all of our sins. Nothing is hidden from his eyes. But that makes him the perfect doctor, the one who can perfectly care for our souls, for our bodies, who perfectly can provide the answer for our sins, for our sinfulness. Jesus says, verse 14, whoever drinks of the water that I will give will never be thirsty forever. Double emphasis, never be thirsty forever. The water that I give will become a spring of water welling up to eternal life in that person. You see, Jesus doesn't just give us a cup of water. He gives us a whole well. In our baptism, the Holy Spirit becomes in us a well of water gushing forth, welling up, a well that will never run dry, a well that will satisfy us all the way to heaven, when we will have there that glorious river that comes from the throne of God. The woman said to Jesus, I know that Messiah, the anointed one, is coming, he who is called Christ. And when he comes, he will tell us all things. And then Jesus says, I who speak to you am he. My friends, that's the same Jesus who speaks to us, the same Jesus whose presence is here, symbolized in an eternal light. The same Jesus who is here in his word. Every time we hear it, every time we read it, pick it up, there is Jesus. I am he. I am with you. That same Jesus who came to us in our baptism, who is that well of water. The same Jesus who comes to us this day in the supper that we might drink and drink deeply of that which truly cleanses us and satisfies our spiritual thirst. Yes, my friends, we live in Africa. We live in the midst of a drought all around us that impacts even ourselves. But we have the well that does not run dry, the well of water that we can even share with those around us who have no water, who need that water, the water of Jesus, a well, a spring, water that flows up, overwhelms us, saturates our parched hearts, our parched souls, our parched minds. Jesus, living water. Drink deeply, my friends. Drink long. Drink full. Be refreshed. Jesus is living water for you. And that, my friends, is the way that it is. This third Sunday in Lent, in the year of our Lord, 2017. In Jesus' name, amen. This time we invite forward those who are joining our congregation this day.
So let us all rise for prayer.
We give you thanks that you are living water. That you come to us in our drought, in our parchedness, in our sinfulness. You come to wash away our sin, to soak and to saturate us with yourself, with your love, with your truth. We pray that we would never look for other things to satisfy and quench our thirst, but that we would turn only to you for that which really satisfies, which really waters us unto eternal life. We pray that you would be that well in us through baptism to life eternal, that you would help us also to share this water, to share this with those in need, with those who are thirsty, in our lives, in our community, among family and friends and neighbors. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, we give you thanks for your goodness and blessings. We give you thanks with James for another year of life, and with all who celebrate special days, that your hand of blessing would rest upon them. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, we pray for those who mourn. We pray that you be with the family of Jean and with all families, dear Lord, who have lost loved ones, that you would surround them with your comfort and peace, that you would be the well of water for them, that you would refresh them, restore them, give to them hope and life. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, we pray also for those who are ill, that you would be with them in their illness, in their needs, that they would know your eternal light and your eternal presence. According to your will, grant them your healing. We commend to your care Beth, Della, Jerry, Ione, Lori, Colleen, Arlo, Ines, Mary, Corey, Char, Dave, Zara, Brandon, Calvin, Mary, Sharon, Jade, Aiden, Jackie, and Lori. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, we pray for the people of Africa, where they have no water, for those whose lives are threatened and whose livelihoods are threatened. We pray, Lord, that you would soon send refreshing rains upon that land. And also we pray, Lord, that you would provide the abundance of the earth to be brought there, that you would use us and people around the world to be able to bring water and food and the resources that are needed. We pray for your hand of protection and safety upon those who deliver aid, and we pray that you might bring aid to all who are in need. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Be seated. We bring now our offerings to the Lord and ask also that you would sign the friendship register at this time. Now we'll ask for those who are joining this day. Beloved in the Lord, our Lord says to his apostles, whoever confesses me before men, I will confess before my Father who is in heaven. And whoever denies me before men, I will also deny before my Father who is in heaven. Lift up your hearts, therefore, to the God of all grace. Joyfully give answer to what I now ask you in the name of the Lord. Do you this day in the presence of God and of this congregation acknowledge the gifts that God gave you in your baptism? So answer, yes, I do.
Yes, I do.
Do you renounce the devil and all his works and all his ways? If so, answer, I do.
I do.
Do you believe in God the Father Almighty, in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, and in the Holy Spirit? If so, answer, yes, I believe.
Yes, I believe.
Do you hold all the prophetic and apostolic scriptures to be the inspired word of God, and the doctrine of the Evangelical Lutheran Church drawn from them and confessed in the small catechism to be faithful and true? So answer, I do.
I do.
Do you intend to hear the word of God and to receive the Lord's Supper faithfully? If so, answer, I do by the grace of God.
I do by the grace of God.
Do you intend to live according to the word of God and in faith, word, and deed, to remain true to God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, even to death? If so, answer, I do by the grace of God.
I do by the grace of God.
Do you desire to become a member of this congregation? If so, answer, I do.
I do.
And will you support the work our gracious Lord has given this congregation with your prayers and the gifts that God has given you? So answer, I will with the help of God.
I will with the help of God.
Upon this, your confession of faith, I acknowledge publicly that you are members of the Evangelical Lutheran Church and of this congregation. Receive the Lord's Supper and participate with us in all the blessings of salvation that our Lord has given to his church. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you for your great goodness in bringing these, your sons and daughters, to the knowledge of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, enabling them both with the heart to believe and with the tongue to confess his saving name. Grant that by your word and spirit they may continue steadfast in the one true faith, in the fellowship of this congregation, as together we await the day when all who have fought the good fight of faith shall receive the crown of righteousness. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you always. Amen. Rise for the service of Holy Communion, found on page 208. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty Everlasting God, for the countless blessings you so freely bestow on us and all creation.
Above all, we give thanks for your boundless love shown to us when you sent your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, into our flesh and laid on him our sin, giving him into death that we might not die eternally. Because he is now risen from the dead and lives and reigns to all eternity, all who believe in him will overcome sin and death and will rise again to new life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, shed for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And drink the true blood of your Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. shed for you for the forgiveness of your sins. Take and drink the true blood of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Shed for you the forgiveness of your sins.
The true body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus, strengthen and preserve you in body and soul until life everlasting. Go now in his peace. Amen. Welcome to the table of the Lord. Rise, we join in the song of Simeon.
Thank you.
O God the Father, the fountain and source of all goodness, who in loving kindness sent your only begotten Son into the flesh, we thank you that for his sake you have given us pardon and peace in this sacrament. And we ask you not to forsake your children, but always to rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that we may be enabled constantly to serve you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Right after the reading. The Lord be with you all, keep you in his care.